Welcome, everybody. We're really happy to have you here this morning. We do want to answer as many questions as possible for you as we talk about assuring quality at the source. All right, with that, I'm handing this over right to Gerhard.
Hi there. To me, this is like one of the most important slides in the entire Shingo collection of slides. Understanding this slide means that you understand the overall concept. It's not a circular slide. It flows in a very distinct way, but let me just walk through it and really kind of at high speed. But the focus of all Shingo principles, the Shingo methodology, whatever you want to call it, is culture, a cultural shift. If we could drive a cultural shift through an organization, we make a huge difference. As a lot of you already know, I'm always full of stories. I was just at the doctor's office a couple of days ago, and you know, there's such a big difference between a doctor that stands and looks at a chart and talks to you by looking at the chart versus a doctor that sits down in the chair, looks you in the eye, you know, flips the darn computer screen over so you can see what he's talking about and talks and shows you on the screen what he's talking about. It doesn't take any a difference in time at all, but the feeling that you come away with is that you got a doctor that cares, a doctor that actually is interested in you. And that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about culture. We're talking about something that makes people want to relate. And if we're trying to drive to that improved culture, we have to go do it via the guiding principles. Now, the guiding principles, of course, in the Shingo model, there's 10 of them broken up into three different dimensions. And we're not going to go through all of those. We are going to focus on one and stress the characteristics of that one. But with those guiding principles established, then you can look at results. Okay, there's two kinds of results. There's the results that the outside world looks at and the type of results that the inside world is motivated by. And those are, of course, referred to as KPIs and KBIs. And it's the KBIs, the ones that motivate the culture, that drive us to success. And we incorporate those KBIs. And now we switch to the box completely over on the other side. We go to systems. We drive those KBIs via systems. That's the hardest part of the entire Shingo methodology, is creating systems that motivate people on KBIs. And if you can understand that flow and understand that then you create systems via tools, then the tools are just there to help you create successful systems, then you got a whole better understanding of how this entire big picture works and how it flows. And of course, creating these systems that motivate are the biggest challenge in the entire methodology. Let's jump to the next slide. These are the 10 guiding principles that that I just mentioned a little while ago. And today we're going to be focusing on assure quality at the source. Go ahead.
So in the lower right-hand corner, you can see where it talks about closing the gap, right? A sustainable culture of organizational excellence. And that's what the Shingo Prize is all about, is creating this sustainable culture. And one of the questions we always ask is, can you get good results with bad behaviors? And the answer is definitely yes. In this month's Shingo newsletter, I talked about my first job out of high school was working in a factory that produced aerospace parts. And the interesting part was the machines were old. The idea was that quality was caught at final inspection. You checked your parts as you were running, but really you waited until final inspection. We even had quality people coming around and checking parts. But people learned how to game the system. If you had a questionable part, you may put it aside, or you may not have them check that part or things like that. The interesting thing was, at final inspection, if a bad batch of parts was found, we sent it to a pickout area And the joke was, you'd never really retired from this company because you'd come out back to pick out. And we had people that had been there for years just doing pick out. And this was all normal. And you can say, can you get good results operating like that? And yeah, we made money. Our quality was actually considered pretty good we were a preferred supplier. Customers didn't like our delivery. That was one thing that they really disliked. But you have to ask yourself, how much money could we have made if we followed the Shingo principles and had quality at the source instead of adding all this extra cost and time and delays of doing it the way we were doing it? And really, you know, if you looked at it, again, that was normal, not a lot of impetus to change. So when you go into Shingo sites today, when I go into Shingo sites, it's amazing. It's a completely different culture, different way of doing things. And this really, I think this first experience shaped a lot of my lean life and the way I look at things. So one of the things I do is, what are the ideal results, the expected results that you want? What are the results that you're getting? What's the gap? There's a great Shingo Prize winning book called Own the Gap about auto leave. And, you know, I'd recommend that you read it, but we're always trying to close this gap, as you can see in the slide. And how do we close that gap with sustainable improvement? That's what we're trying to do. And the key word, again, is sustainable. A lot of companies put tools in and some systems. They get initially good results, but they can't sustain them. Eventually, they'll fail. Jennifer, the next slide. So what are the ideal results that you want? Well, where I worked before, quality the first time without final inspection. That would have been the ideal result. People say, well, you know, this can't be applied. This is manufacturing. These principles can be applied to any industry. If you want to, correct processing of claims without errors, correct surgical procedures, completed projects on time without errors, we've seen it all. And people are doing it out in the world today. And as you can see, this principle can be used in any industry. So what are the ideal results? Well, 100% quality the first time without final inspection. At the time, we had high reject rates at final inspection. So still, again, it was not enough impetus to change the way we were doing things. We thought we were successful. What's the gap? That's what I'm always looking at. What behaviors are driving this? What's the gap? How do we close that gap by changing the behaviors? We had very unhappy customers as far as late deliveries. They didn't like our cost, even though we were making money. We were a high-priced company. And, you know, as competition came in, it hurt us because people were doing it better, faster, and cheaper than we were. So it was a serious blow eventually. Next slide.
All right. What are the principles that you should follow to create a system? I spent a fair bit of time over there in Japan talking to them, working with the Toyota people and so on, mostly on books and stuff. And there's a whole lot of stories that go along with that, but we're going to try to limit that. One of the biggest principles that came out of that I got, and that still seems to be really weak in most Lean Six Sigma environments. And that is, if you're creating a system and you want people to use that system, you always make the right thing easier to do than the wrong thing. Too many times when we create systems, what we're doing is we're, you know, if we have a problem, we have a glitch, something comes up that doesn't work right, what do? We tend to put a patch on it. And by putting a patch on it, what we're doing is complicating the system, adding another failure point, making the thing take longer, that type of a thing. These patches do not improve the system. What they do, in fact, is create more failure. And what we need to do is redesign that system. And so what principles should we follow to create systems? the guiding principles are what defines what our systems should drive towards. And from that, we come up with these key behavioral indicators, or these behaviors that we want the system to drive. You know, you can't tell somebody on the floor that, hey, your goal is to increase profitability, and have them understand what that means to them. It doesn't work that way. You have to give them behaviors that they can follow, and then use those behaviors to make a difference in the job that they're doing. You have to give them something that they can use as a metric to drive their behavior. And let me tell you, another thing that you've learned, that we learned really quickly, is that if you don't give employees behaviors, if you don't tell employees what is the most important, what metric they should be following, they'll make it up themselves. And the chance is that they'll make up a behavior, they'll make up a metric that maybe contradicts what you're trying to accomplish as the big picture. So what systems do you have to create to drive ideal expected behaviors? I'll guarantee you that you won't get it the first time. It's going to take iterations. You create a system, and there's many stories that go along with that, a lot more than we have time for. But there's many systems that drive behaviors, and that have done it in such a way that we look towards the ideal, but then we have to modify and adjust over time. Things are not static. Things require continuous improvement, believe it or not. And that includes the systems you create. But you create those systems focused on the behaviors, on the guiding principles, and that's probably the hardest part of the entire Shingo methodology. And what tools do you need in these systems? The answer is really, really vague. There's over 100 different types of tools in the Toyota production methodology. In the TPM, there's over 100 different tools. And what we tend to do is we know one tool, whatever it is, spaghetti charting or systems flow charting or value stream mapping or whatever. We tend to lock in on one tool and think that that's one tool fits everything that we do. And that's just not true. And it's just not right. We need to, our job as continuous improvement advisors is to find the right tool that will help create the right system that motivates the appropriate behaviors. And that's a trick. It's not easy, but that's what we're trying to learn and teach and work through as we go through the Shingo methodology. That's what the Shingo methodology tries to teach us, is how to create these systems that motivate the appropriate behaviors, that give us the results that drive towards ideal behaviors or ideal results. Go ahead.
Well, and one of the things that Gerhard and I always talk about is that you can get these systems by design and creating them, or you can get them by accident. If you get them by accident, the bad behaviors become the accepted behaviors. So if you have a system where people are allowed to come in late, or there's really no expectations, your good people start adopting those behaviors, and it spirals out of control. So that's the importance of creating systems that give you the behaviors you want, and you'll get the results that you want. So assure quality at the source is you're really not passing defects forward. When we go into Shingo prize-winning sites, if there's a problem, things stop and you fix the problem right away. It's a scientific method. It doesn't wait until it gets to final inspection, days or weeks later, and then you have to go back and kind of do forensic quality detection and figure out what went wrong. It's solved right there at that moment. And that's, if you go to any of the Toyota car manufacturing plants, that's what you see. They stop the line. So from an executive's perspective, it takes a lot of courage to stop the process long enough to understand the root cause and to put countermeasures in place to prevent it from reoccurring. A lot of times executives and managers will be saying, well, how can I do this? I'm too busy right now. And the answer is, well, you want to get away from that firefighting, those workarounds, which is how we spend most of our time. We're always trying to fix things that aren't following the process, rather than putting the processes in place where they run the way they're supposed to. So from a manager's perspective, systems must be in place to ensure that any results that varies from the standard, even slightly, creates an expectation of support and immediate action. So it's called swarming. And again, you see this at Shingo Prize winning plants, where if there's a problem, you get all the support you need, and it's solved, and it's corrective actions are put in place so that it doesn't happen again. And as that young guy, a team member back when I first started, I wouldn't pass any defect forward, right? It would have more ownership, accountability. I'm involved with the quality now rather than expecting that somebody else, in this case, final inspection, would pick out good from bad. That's not the way you want to do it. Next slide. So one of the interesting things that we see all the time is that people will do Kaizen events and you start getting this scattered approach. Hey, we have a problem over here. Let's do a Kaizen event. And Mr. Amai talks about Kaizen every day, everywhere, everybody. And again, what you see in these Shingo Prize winning plants is the culture is, this is just the way we work. We're always improving. We're always looking for better ways. We're always trying new things to improve and really stretch ourselves, get to the next level, seek perfection. Again, it's every day, everywhere, everybody. That's what Kaizen should really be. It shouldn't be just an event every month or the scattered approach.
Yeah, it shouldn't just be, we're doing a lean event and we're going to do it this week and then we'll do it again in a year from now. That's not the Kaizen approach. Even though we use that word for it, it's not the Kaizen approach.
So assured quality at the source really has enormous benefits. So it's a leading indicator that your products are going to be right and ready to ship on time to the customer. I always use quality and actually 5S as leading indicators for safety, for instance. If I see quality slipping, if I see 5S slipping, I know we're going to have a safety incident because we're rushing, we're not following our process, procedures. So for me, it's a leading indicator. And you can really, if you can have quality at the source, it takes one worry away. You don't have margin erosion. I've seen a lot of companies where, again, as I talked about in the beginning of my career, I don't know how much money we spent on reworks and picking out parts. And kind of our joke was, oh, we always have time for reworks, but we don't have time to do it right the first time. Again, there's a lot of money that is spent doing these reworks and pick outs and things like that. So it's one of the principles really that help you create the stable, predictable, repeatable process, which besides the financial benefits, it really reduces worker stress, allows them to focus on improvement activities instead of firefighting and workarounds. That's one of the big things. It's a much nicer atmosphere to work in if you know that your process is capable and you don't have to do all this firefighting and workarounds. So inventory down, cycle time down, waste down, rework down, and really customer satisfaction increasing, on-time deliveries up, capacity up. That's the things that we see at Shingo Prize winning plants.
Yeah, I was brought into a company once that had a 13% defect rate, and it was pretty much destroying their profitability. And what they were doing was they were creating product and overproducing every time because of the 13%. So they always did a 20% over production on everything they did. And the job was, okay, get the quality to where it should be. And in the end, yeah, we got it down in about 6 months time, we got it down to 2% using basically Shingo principles, Shingo methodology. But the surprise was in the end was, hey, now we don't have to have finished goods inventory anymore. Now we don't have to have all this storage space. Now our cycle time is much quicker. Now we don't have all the waste that we used to have. We don't have the rework. All those benefits, just they're kind of side benefits. They weren't even what we were driving towards, But, you know, the biggest thing that surprised him was that they had now about a 20% increase in capacity. And that was huge money for them, a 20% increase in capacity, because they don't spend so much time overbuilding and doing rework. And so the benefits of quality at the source is huge. And, you know, in this company, it just took about 6 months to make that turnaround. But the turnaround was based on a cultural change within the organization, to where employees felt empowered, employees felt like they had ownership, and they went in and they made the quality work. They got a mentality that we do not produce bad parts, and that mentality drove them to make changes that made a huge difference in that organization. And we got hundreds of examples like this, but that was one that I lived through, so I thought I'd share that.
Well, and quality is really king. I can guarantee, through my experiences for, you know, running plants for many, many years, if you're having quality issues, you're also having delivery issues. You're also having cost issues, and you're probably having safety issues. So if you start fixing quality through, you know, assured quality at the source, a lot of those other problems start going away. Next slide.
Perfect. I think we might be at the point where we should take some questions. So I know we have several here. Some we answered as we went through, but why don't we take the first one? So can you provide an example and definition of systems? I've seen this used, this term used interchangeable with tools, processes, methodologies, etc.
You know, even at Shingo, we struggled to actually wrap our arms around that, and we ended up putting up one of the six courses is totally about systems and what does that mean as far as the Shingo methodology goes. And so it's clarified in that course in detail, and you get a lot of exercises and practices around it. So my number one recommendation is you ought to take that course. But yeah, that term system is used so loosely, and it is very specific as far as you know, the Shingo methodology is concerned. It has something coming into it, it has a process, it has something coming out of it, it has feedback. That's a system. That entire thing is a system, and it could be at several different levels. There are subsystems within systems. But it's a lot more than just a process. It has to have the full SIPOC, the full supplier input, process, output, customer. It has to have the full SIPOC, including the feedback. And that gets you, that helps clarify for you what is a system. Now, the one piece that doesn't stress is that there has to be a metric in there as well. To drive that system to ideal results, you have to have a metric in there that helps the whoever's using that system, helps them understand what is important to you, what do you need in order to make what do you need in order to make that user of the system successful. And so you need a metric in there as well. And there's a lot of rules that go along with metrics that we can't really spend a lot of time on right now, but, you know, too many metrics is as good as no metric, and so on. And you want behavior metrics, KBIs, behavior metrics that drive behaviors in the appropriate direction and all that. But you get all of that in the systems workshop. I hope that answers the question.
Let me switch us to another question here, just because I know we're running short on time. Can you give an example of a behavior given to an employee to help with quality at the source?
So in my case, as a, you know, young person starting out, some of the behaviors that would have been good, and we talk about systems. So now machines are old, so you need a maintenance system, right? You need a preventive maintenance system to make sure the machines are capable. We had a financial system where we're running piecework. So you have to look at your financial system and create one that encourages the right behavior. In this case, it was piecework. So quality was really number two on the list. It was how many pieces can you make? So changing that would be one way. And that's a tough one. And we don't have enough time you don't have enough time to talk about all that. So really, it's just changing the expectations of what you want from that process. And it really starts at all levels. There was a question about, well, where do you start? Well, every level has to do this right, right? You have to look at the value stream. You can't just look at one part of it and say, well, we want to improve quality there. If it gets to the next process and you're having, you know, quality issues, you've defeated your purpose. So you want to make sure that quality at the source is at every step, whether it's from, you know, from an office as they're doing the orders through shipping, right? Make sure that everyone is looking at quality at the source and improving the process. That's every day, everywhere, everyone.
Perfect.
Yeah, and I gave right at the start, I gave kind of a what I thought was an example of quality at the source, where the doctor sits down, looks you in the eye, and explains to you directly what's going on, as opposed to somebody that's standing there looking at that's quality at the source in the medical sector to me. Quality is, you know, a lot more than just, you know, not making a broken part. It's also in the perception of the customer. It's also in the relationship with who you're working with. It's all of those things. So it fits every industry. Go ahead.
Just one example, and it was really an epiphany for me. I was at Toyota in San Antonio, Texas, the Tacoma Tundra truck plant. They have a truck coming off every 60 seconds. And what they said is, if we manage that 60-second time frame, we know our safety is good, our quality is good, our cost is good, and our delivery is good. So they know they have a problem every 60 seconds. And that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to get to that root cause or that problem identification as quickly as possible. So in my example, you know, in working in aerospace, if we had a quality problem, if I had a quality problem, I might not hear about that for days or weeks or maybe never. And if somebody came back to me 3 weeks later and said, hey, you ran these parts, they were bad, I don't remember what happened, right? It all blurred into things. If we find out that we have a problem every 60 seconds, I know exactly what happened, right? And we can fix it. We can put root cause corrections in place. And that's what you see again in Shingo prize winning sites. They fix things, they try to identify things as fast as you can. And that's really continuous improvement and operational excellence.
So I think we might have time for one more question here. The one that I wanted to go through is, how can we apply quality at the source principles and a service organization or transactional type of processes?
Well, I'm going to go back to, just to not have to get into a different story, but I'm going to go back to the medical example. That's quality at the source in a service industry. We did a whole hospital, several of them, but this one was a major hospital. And quality at the source for the hospital was, they were so wrapped up in the numbers, you know, we got to get the patients through as quickly as possible with the lowest cost possible, that kind of a thing. But when they shifted over to thinking about quality at the source as being your relationship with the patient and how you assist the patient and your response time for that patient, when they shifted their thinking to that, it became quality at the source. They were driving the source being the customer, they were driving that quality relationship, as opposed to, you know, we got to make money and get stuff through as quickly as possible. And then we changed the way the OR area worked. We changed the way ER worked. We changed the labs. All of those things were not oriented towards quality at the source. But if we changed, like for the lab, for example, if the lab realized that there's a difference between somebody that's sitting in the ER waiting for results versus somebody that's already got a room, and you know, whether you get that information back in get the results back in an hour or so, it doesn't make a lot of difference. When they realized that difference and they started focusing on that quality at the source, then it started making a huge impact on how quick the response time in ER worked. I mean, that was just one example, but yeah.
Well, they do that at Cleveland Clinic, where the doctor and the nurse visit the patient, and they talk about the care. How was the care? And they have a list of questions they ask. And you could do it two ways. You could send out a survey and get the survey back. And then if there's any issues, try to figure out what happened, right? Or as Cleveland Clinic's doing, you can go in, talk to the patient, doctor and nurse, and they tell you right there, and you can fix it right there, right? Now you know you've changed the behavior. If something's going wrong and the patient brings up a good point, you can change it right there. You're not waiting weeks or things, you know, months to try to go in and change something and figure out what happened, right? You can figure it out right at the time it's happening.